I, Don D. Costin,
pledge myself to accept the full responsibility of the office of president of Charleston Southern University.
And willing.
Dr. Don D. Costin is the third president to serve at CSU since the founding of Charleston Southern University in 1964.
Put him there. I stand here today as a nobody who knows a somebody. Amen. Who has called all of us to serve everybody. And that's what this ceremony is all about.
His leadership has already been felt on the campus.
So in Mark 10:45, it gives a great example of what leadership is and what it's about. So Jesus is, whenever Jesus comes and he serves, he came not to be served upon, but he came so that he can serve others. And that's one thing that I see Dr. Costin doing. He's serving the student body.
He's really good at like inspiring the crowd and really making it feel like Jesus' presence is in the room and stuff. So.
Seeing him put his trust in God, and God then gives him the skills that he needs to get through each job.
Leadership, plain and simple, is influence. But ultimately, it's a leader who is trying to influence a team of people to accomplish a specific mission. I know the old saying goes, if you think you're a leader and you turn around and no one's following you, then you're only taking a walk in the woods.
Dr. Costin has been inspired most by an early leader in his life, and his vast experience has prepared him to take on this role.
I believe that the most important leader I ever saw was somebody who never had one second of college. That was my own father. He owned a small business. And what I saw was that, again, before I even learned how leadership is supposed to work, I saw him doing it. It's, if you take care of the people, they will take care of the mission. And so he treated his employees so well. He had almost zero turnover in his small business because they loved him and he loved them back, and they knew it.
I would say that he is probably three things. He's a visionary leader, he is a listening leader, and he's a loving leader.
Early in his Air Force career, Dr. Costin adopted his foundational leadership model, and it remains true today. Dr. Costin came ready to apply his leadership philosophy.
The first leadership model I ever learned in the Air Force way back in the day was leadership really is two things. It's people and mission. And if you take care of the people, they will take care of the mission. So when I think about leadership, I really think about this acrostic that spells out leaders. The first is the lordship principle, the L. Lordship means whoever you work for, your ultimate boss is the Lord. Your job, whatever place you have in the organization, your job is to glorify God in that job. And if he wants to keep you in that job for the next 60 years, that's the Lord's business, not yours. And your job is to be content there. Your job is to produce there. Your job is to glorify him there. And if you do, in almost every case, your bosses will recognize that and you'll be promoted eventually. But lordship is first. You work for the Lord first and foremost. The first E in leaders is in what I call the environment principle. The leader's job is to orchestrate the kind of culture in the organization that will be most productive for people and mission. And so it's knowing how people are motivated, it's trying to think big thoughts, it's knowing what the resources are, but it's creating this environment that says, when you come to work, you know that you work for the Lord, and it's part of the process. The A I refer to as accountability. Accountability says, if you think that just because you're getting away with stuff at work and fooling your boss, and you think that's good enough because you still get your paycheck, then you failed. Because your ultimate accountability has to be to the Lord. But your boss also is going to hold you accountable, as she should. I mean, your boss should come to you and say, I ask you for these results, because it's not an employment agency here. This is about the mission. Where are they? And accountability is part of that. The next a letter in the acrostic is D, development. Because sometimes a person who is not holding the standard high or not achieving what you ask them to do, it's your job as the boss, as the leader, to make sure that that person has the resources they need, has the training they need, has the motivation they need to get the job done. And so development says you hold people accountable, sure, but you give them the opportunity to grow in the job that they've been given. Again, not for themselves alone, but for the sake of the mission. The next D in the acrostic is the execution principle. And so execution says the leader's job is to align mission, vision, values, strategy, all of this so that we can figure out how we're doing today. We can look at where we want, how we want to be doing tomorrow and next week and next month and next year, and develop a strategy to execute the mission, getting from point A to point B. The R in leaders is closely related to the other two, accountability and execution. So the R is results. In the end, your organization is judged based on results. And if it's a profit organization, a for-profit organization, then how much money you make really is a good bit of why you're in business. It's not the only reason you're in business, right? I mean, you're in business not just to reap financial rewards. You're in business to impact the community. And I would say impact the community for the kingdom of God. The last letter of the acrostic, the S, is what I call the shepherd principle. And I go to 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, in which, you know, Peter is talking to pastors, generally speaking. But if you read the passage and you substitute just shepherd, if you think not just pastor, but leader, you just put that in there. The passage says that a shepherd's job is to be the under-shepherd of the good shepherd, the Lord, and treat your people as if God is treating them like his own flock. And then it goes on to say, it talks about character. It also talks about the fact that one day this great shepherd will appear and there will be accountability. And so if you were to go back sometime and just with these principles, lordship, environment, accountability, development, execution, results, and then the shepherd principle, I think you will see all seven of those in that passage from first to last, because ultimately we answer to the good shepherd, and God will judge us not based strictly on how profitable we've been or how much the organization has grown, but how effective we have been in treating our people, again, for the advancement of the kingdom of God. So that's my leadership philosophy in a nutshell.
Although Dr. Costin has a resume that would impress anyone, he believes leadership is a calling for each person.
Yeah, I think one of the challenges we have when we talk about leadership, I think we sometimes mistake that leadership is only the person at the top of the organizational chart and everybody else is a follower, and that's a fallacy. The fallacy is that if you are in an organization, if you're in a family, if you're in a classroom, every person in there has some responsibility for leadership. You may be leading the person in the desk next to you, for instance. But your job, again, the same principles I just mentioned, your job is to make sure that when you leave that person, or when that person leaves your classroom or your organization, they're better off than when they came. There ought to be some sort of benefit to the person based on their association with you. I would say every human being who is made by God, which is all of us, is called to lead in some way. And it may be something small, but it may be the kind of leadership that, that they're never going to write books about, they're never going to, make a movie about you, but you've been called to lead.
Ultimately, Dr. Costin is an agent for Christ, drawing others closer to the Savior through his leadership.
Most people just know, just as you talk to him, he is a loving person and he cares so deeply about everyone. But I think his call, to have people come to know Christ and to share Christ with others.
As Michael read to us earlier, this institution is the answer
to somebody's prayer. All these buildings, all these people, the legacy is the answer to somebody's prayer. I would just ask you to remember that if you show up to work here in any capacity, so are you. Amen.
And Vicky is my favorite singer. There's no singer on the planet that I would pay money to see more than I would pay money to hear Vicky sing. And so that's kind of, I met her when she was singing in church. I was like, whoa. Yeah, this is going to work out for me. So I joined the choir.
And then he, yes, Francis McBride, have you met him? He's a double major. He even knew my GPA. So he was like, 3.7 GPA. Yeah, he's a double major, blah. And I'm like, wow. That's so he literally studies the student body. And that really impressed me.
He's a little shorter than I expected.